If you're familiar with my channel, you know I've done a fair number of VR-specific GPU performance reviews. In some of those videos, like the one for the 8GB model of the RTX 4060 Ti, and more recently the RX 7600, I said I suspected the 8GB of VRAM on those cards was holding them back some in several of the titles I tested, but that I'd also need to do some further digging to verify that. Well, I just spent the past couple of weeks testing 4 different GPUs in hopes of answering that question, and the TLDR is, it depends on the game you're playing.
No way!
In my RX 7600 VR performance video, I used MSI Afterburner to monitor the GPU, frame buffer, and VRAM usage. My thought at the time was between the VRAM usage and frame buffer usage numbers, I should be able to get an accurate picture of how much VRAM was being used and whether or not the 7600 was being limited by its 8GB of VRAM. Well, since making that video, I've done some more research into what exactly the frame buffer is, and it's not quite what I thought it was. On YouTube, amongst the PC DIY community, the terms frame buffer and VRAM are used interchangeably, which led me to believe they were just different names for the same thing.
No way! You gotta be kidding! That's not right!
The frame buffer actually only occupies a portion of a graphics card's available VRAM. The majority of a graphics card's VRAM is occupied by other important data needed to run your games, which is primarily textures, but there's also other things like character and other object models, as well as shaders and lighting information, among a bunch of other things. What I'm getting at here is what I thought I understood about the VRAM usage number in Afterburner and the frame buffer percentage was incorrect. I was under the understanding that the VRAM usage was simply showing how much VRAM was being allocated for use by the game being run, and the frame buffer percentage was how much VRAM was actively being utilized. It turns out the numbers are much more straightforward than that. The frame buffer utilization shows what percentage of that small amount of a graphics card's VRAM that has been set aside for use as the frame buffer is being used. At least that's how it's being reported with the Nvidia GPUs I tested. AMD seems to be reporting a percentage of the total VRAM on the card that's being used as the frame buffer, but I'll talk about that a bit more later. Anyway, as for VRAM utilization, it shows how much VRAM is being utilized by all applications and processes currently running on your PC. So yeah, when games were showing VRAM usage up around 8GB, they were in fact maxing out the 8GB of VRAM on the card. Now, just because all the VRAM was being utilized doesn't mean our performance was being limited. Some games are programmed to load as much stuff into VRAM as there's available room for, so that when that data is required, it's right there, ready for the GPU to process without adversely affecting game performance. A good example of this is Half-Life Alyx. While making my VR performance video for the RX 7600, I noted Half-Life Alyx using around 4.5GB of VRAM during the 15 or so minutes I usually run my tests for. However, while running tests for this video, I found the longer I played Alyx, the more VRAM was shown being utilized, and eventually all 8GB was shown as being utilized. But I didn't suffer any kind of performance degradation. The game continued to run smoothly the entire time. To see just how much VRAM Half-Life Alyx would utilize, I swapped in the 7900 XTX, which has 24GB of VRAM, and using the exact same resolution, refresh rate, and game settings I used with the 7600, when I completed my test, Afterburner was reporting VRAM usage above 20GB. So while Half-Life Alyx doesn't need more than 8GB of VRAM to run, if your GPU has more than 8GB, it will use it. During my testing with the 7600, there was a handful of other games that also reached 8GB of VRAM usage, or very near it, so I tested them with the 7900 XTX as well, and they all ended up utilizing more than 8GB too. It was during these tests that I noticed it seems like AMD GPUs are reporting the frame buffer usage as a percentage of the total VRAM available on the card being utilized, because the 7900 XTX was consistently reporting a frame buffer usage percentage of about one-third that of the 7600. And seeing as the 7900 XTX has three times the total VRAM, you can see how I made that correlation. As I'm sure you know, comparing the performance of the 7600 and the 7900 XTX is in no way helpful for determining whether 8GB of VRAM is limiting our VRAM performance or not, because the 7900 XTX is a vastly more powerful GPU. So once I'd identified the games that like to use more than 8GB of VRAM, I bought an RTX 4060 Ti 16GB graphics card and began testing it and comparing its performance to the results I got when I reviewed the 8GB model of the 4060 Ti. Since we're using the exact same GPU core, the only difference being the amount of VRAM on the card, we should see exactly how much difference the additional VRAM makes. Because I tested the 16GB 4060 Ti with Nvidia's most current 537.34 driver, once I'd finished testing it, I went back and retested the 8GB card too, so we can get a 100% apples to apples comparison. For those of you that have seen my 4060 Ti 8GB video, you may remember there were several games where I experienced stuttering when playing at 120Hz. Namely Pavlov, Breachers, Red Matter 2, and The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners. Turning the refresh rate down to 90Hz from 120 fixed the stuttering problem, but at the same time, I wondered if the stuttering was due to not having enough VRAM to run those games at the resolution, refresh rate, and detail settings I had used. Having the 16GB 4060 Ti to compare to, we can now see whether or not that theory was correct. And it turns out I was wrong. Initially, while doing tests in those games with the 16GB card using the same settings I got stuttering with during my first go around with the 8GB 4060 Ti, I felt I might be right because it ran all those games perfectly. However, when I swapped the 8GB model back in, it too ran all those games perfectly at the same settings I had previously had stuttering with. So it appears the stuttering I experienced in my review video was either a driver bug that has now been addressed in the 537.34 driver, or what I feel is the most likely, there was a bug in the Oculus PC app which has since been patched. Overall, in the majority of the games I tested, having 16GB of VRAM versus 8GB of VRAM made no difference. Which makes sense, seeing as all the games I tested were made prior to graphics cards having more than 8GB of VRAM on them. Both cards were able to achieve the same resolution, refresh rate, and game settings. All that is but one. In Lone Echo 2, I did see an advantage to having 16GB of VRAM. Both cards ran the game at 3936 by 1984 at 72Hz using the game's high graphics quality preset. However, the 16GB model was able to turn MSAA up to 4x, while the 8GB card would only run smoothly without MSAA on. I also ran into times with the 8GB card in Lone Echo 2 where the framerate would completely crap out once we hit VRAM utilization around 8GB, and the framerate would not come back until I restarted the game. So circling back to the TLDR spoiler at the beginning of the video, 8GB of VRAM is enough for VR in late 2023. That being said, going forward, there's no question new VR games coming out over the next several years are going to take advantage of the higher VRAM capacities of the newer graphics cards. So if you're in the market today for a new graphics card and a GPU with 12GB, 16GB or more fits into your budget, I would seriously suggest considering those options over ones with 8GB or less. Subscribe!
Hey guys! Whoa, big gulps, huh? Alright. Well, see you later.